layperson and the muni, the recluse, the monk. Buddha said, peacock is beautiful with its feathers, its neck, blue neck. With this, the peacock is beautiful. And the swan is not that beautiful. Though they, in comparison to their speed, peacock cannot fly that fast, though it's beautiful. But the swan can fly fast. The peacock is the layperson. Swan is the monk. In comparison to these two, the Buddha said, the monk's journey is faster than layperson. It's clear. Friends, I am glad to be here with you today, to see you all today with Bhante Jayamedho from Indonesia. Few minutes ago, I met Bhante Jayamedho. This first time in my life. So I am very happy to see this Bhante also. He is with me today. So we all are here to listen to the Dhamma. Dhamma is a different thing. Dhamma is the word of the Buddha. This Dhamma was well expounded by the Buddha. We are so fortunate to listen to this Dhamma, to understand this Dhamma, and to practice this Dhamma. One day, we will get the real benefit of this Dhamma within this very world. Today, for this Dhamma talk, the suggested topic is how to nurture Sangha qualities in lay life. Sangha, this term, first of all, we should understand the term Sangha. Sangha basically is the part of the triple gem, Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. So you can understand what Sangha is. Sangha, the term Sangha is used as a part of the triple gem. In the Buddhist context, Sangha means very important as it is part of this triple gem. This society can be classified, stratified in different manner. In the time of the Buddha, the society was stratified, classified by Brahmins. They classified this society into four groups according to their caste system. They said the Brahmins, the prominent class or caste. Then the second class was the kings, Kshatriya. Brahmins first, Brahmins, Kshatriyas, then Vaishya, the merchants, and the Shudras, the slaves. Those are four classes. They, how the Brahmin said, according to the Buddha's teaching, the Buddha has pointed out that in this society there are two levels according to the spirituality. Bhikkhu, the monastic, or the laypersons. Those are the two. Again, the bhikkhu, monastic, are twofold, bhikkhu and bhikkhuni. Then the lay society, the upasaka and upasika. Buddha never used the sangha, the term sangha, for lay persons. So today we see the term sangha is used even in the lay society to show that the group, the meaning sangha, that means today the term sangha is used to denote a certain group. I don't see that it is bad. Though the term sangha, when we use the term sangha, we have to understand clearly the sangha means a community, a group, work together, work as a team for a purpose, for a goal, for a particular goal. That is sangha group. When we use the term, we have to understand that it's a group working together for a clear purpose. That is how the Buddha established this sangha society called bhikkhu and bhikkhuni. Bhikkhu order and bhikkhuni order. So sangha, lay society, sangha or the lay society, how different qualities to be nurtured in lay society, how to nurture sangha qualities in lay society is the topic. As I see, we all, whether we are monastic or lay persons, we all need to do good deeds. That is our first thing to understand as lay persons and also the monastic. Good deeds. The Buddha said, all Buddhas teach us not to do evils and but to do good deeds. What we call punya. Once the Buddha said, Gihi bhutasapi upakarani punyani, pabbajitasapi upakarani punyani, deva bhutasa upakarani punyani, manusha bhutasapi upakarani punyani. That means, everybody, whether we are laypersons, monastic, devas or humans, we all need punya, merit, wholesome. We all need this. Therefore, he said, Ma punya bhai, don't be afraid to do good deeds. Ma punya bhai, don't be afraid of doing good deeds. We have to do good deeds again and again, again and again. That is the instruction of the Buddha. When we do good deeds, we can be here, be happy here in this world and the hereafter. Ida nandati pecha nandati kata punyo ubhayatta nandati. That is how the Buddha said. The doer of good deeds rejoices here in this world and the hereafter. Therefore, his advice is to do good deeds again and again. So when we think of qualities, what are the qualities to be nurtured? The qualities in lay society, lay sangha, as I see, the most important thing, the most important quality is right understanding. Without right understanding, we cannot go our way. No path, no way to go. Right understanding is the most important thing. When we think of right understanding, first and foremost, the right understanding is doing good deeds, good understanding right and wrong, understand in wholesome and unwholesome, understand in what is wholesome, what is unwholesome. This is important. That is right understanding, one level of right understanding. Right understanding is necessary in any society. It's not necessary only the Buddhist. In any society, any institute, any organization, right understanding is very much significant. In order to understand things rightly, correctly, the most important thing is talking. We have to talk each other. We have to talk each other. That is very important. Therefore, the Buddha recommended us frequent meetings. Frequently we have to meet. As laypersons or monastic, we have to get together. Frequently we have to talk each other. When we talk, Buddha said, when we talk, we have to, again, we have to understand the proper time. Buddha said, Buddha gave us five different things to concern, referring to our talk. Kalena bhasitang. Buddha said, when you talk, try to talk at the proper time, right time. Kalena bhasitang. Then, Satcha cha bhasitang. When you talk about what is truth, what is beneficial. Talk what is truth. Satcha cha bhasitang. Then Sangha cha bhasitang. When you talk softly, gently. Kalena bhasitang, Satcha cha bhasitang, Sangha cha bhasitang. Then atta sanghitena bhasitang, talk something beneficial, something meaningful. Then metta chittena bhasitang, talk with metta thought. These are the five things to be concerned when we talk. So when the Buddha said frequent meeting is an undefeated factor, there are seven undefeated factors. According to the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, Buddha pointed out seven undefeated factors. Of the seven, the first thing is frequent meeting. Secondly, the Buddha said, when you meet with concord, with harmony, concord, and work, talk, harmony. And also, when you dispatch and end your talk, end your meeting, end your work with harmony. These are very important. These are very important factors to cultivate. So, right understanding is the first thing. Right understanding is completed. Is accomplished with right understanding, right intention, right speech, and right mindfulness. These four are like four shapes, square like. We have to understand these four with right understanding. When we talk about right understanding, when we are understanding right things, right understanding, we have to understand without right thinking, we cannot understand rightly, correctly. Then when we speak, we have to conceptualize. Without conceptualize, no right words coming. Therefore, Right understanding is depend on right intention and right speech as well. For this purpose, it is necessary right mindfulness as well. Therefore, right understanding depends on right intention, word and mindfulness as well. So when we talk about right intention, but there is wrong intention as well. There is a wrong path, not only wrong intention, wrong path. Wrong understanding, wrong intention, wrong speech, wrong actions, wrong livelihood, like that. There's a wrong path. First of all, we have to refrain from wrong path. And then only we can come to right path. Wrong intention. What is wrong intention? Intention is our concept. How we think. When we think, our attention should be wise attention, which is called yoniso manasikar. If the intention is wrong, that is called ayoniso manasikar. With ayoniso manasikar, with unwise attention, we cannot come to right attention. Right attention, right intention is possible only with right attention. When we have wrong attention, it is wrong intention also. So, yoniso manasikara and ayoniso manasikara are to be understood. When we have ayoniso manasikara, unwise attention, we are thinking of doing something unwholesome. With ayoniso manasikara, we have concept. What are the type of concept? Kama vitakka, vyapada vitakka, vihinsa vitakka. Kama vitakka, we think of doing something to gratify our senses. Kama vitakka. Then our concepts are based on unwise attention. Kama vitakka, what we develop are kama vitakka. Sensual thought. Kama vitakka. Then vyapada vitakka, we are thinking of doing something ill will, vyapada, to do something wrong based on ill will. Our will is ill. Then vihinsa vitakka, to do something cruelty. Those are because of our wrong or unwise attention. We should have wise attention. That is called yoniso manasikar, wise attention. With wise attention, we start to think properly, rightly, correctly, because our understanding is right. If our understanding is wrong, definitely our attention, intention are wrong. That is why, friends, I said the most important thing is right understanding. Sammaditti. That is the first factor of the path. The most important factor of the path. We are following the Buddha's path. Buddha's path is nothing but this middle path, the Noble Eightfold Path. So when we have right intention, we think of doing something good. What are the type of things to be done what is called good, good intention, right intention. We think to share things with others, to give others, to offer others, offer the virtuous ones. These are good thoughts called nekkamma sankappa. Nekkamma is to give up, rather hoarding, abandon. Nekkamma sankappa. Renunciation. Thought of renunciation. Nekkamma sankappa. Then avyapada sankappa. Non-ill will. Concept of non-ill will. Rather ill will. Non-ill will. Which is metta. Loving thoughts. Goodwill. Loving friendliness. Thought of loving friendliness. Metta. Then non-cruelty. Non-cruelty. Avihinsa. Avihinsa sankappo. Non-ill will. We never do harm to others, other beings. Even an ant, we never harm. Such thoughts, right intention. When we have right understanding, right intention, then we put this into word, which is called right speech. Verbalize. We conceptualize. What we conceptualize is verbalized. When we verbalize it, we talk about good thing, right thing. We refrain from wrong thing, wrong talk. Wrong talk means, first and foremost, refrain from false speech. Refraining from false speech is very much important for our practice. Once the Buddha said, if one breaks this one precept, one can do anything wrong. Why? You can do anything wrong and say no. No, I did not do. Natti papang akaryang, that is the Buddha said. That is what the Buddha said. Natti papang akaryang, those who break this precept, for such people, there is nothing that they cannot do unbeneficial, unwholesome. He or she can do anything wrong. So, the Buddha, preparing to this precept, refraining from false speech, telling lies, whatever, whether it is white lies, some people say white lie. No such thing to call white lies. Lies are always black. No white lies. So, referring to this, Venerable, the Buddha once heard that his son, Rahula, the novice Rahula, he was a sort of little liar, telling lies. So the Buddha went to meet him. When he went to meet him, it is the tradition in India that a basin full of water is kept in front of the door to wash one's feet. When the Buddha went there, the basin full of water was there. Buddha washed his feet and left little water in the basin. And then Buddha saw this to Rahula. Rahula, see. Buddha said, Rahula, see. There is only little water in the basin. Just like that, the person who tell lies, his virtue is like this, very little. Then the Buddha threw this water away and said, "See, Rahula, the water, thrown water." Just like that, the person who tells lies, his virtue is like that, something thrown away. Again, Buddha kept the basin upside down and said, "See, this is like the person who tells lies, his life, his virtue, his life is something like upside down." So in this manner, the Buddha taught him the lesson, this little one, when he was around 7 years. Buddha taught this lesson to him and said, "Do not tell lies even for fun. So that therefore we have to take this, and if we refrain from telling lies, refrain from false speech, what should we do? We have to talk what is truth, what is right, what is good, what is beneficial. That is what we have to do. So refrain from false speech, refrain from malicious talk, refrain from harsh speech, refrain from frivolous talk. This is what is called right speech. When you refrain from this, you have to do what is right. Refraining from false speech, you have to talk what is right, what is truth. Refraining from malicious talk, divisive talk, we should talk to unite people. Then refrain from harsh speech, we have to talk what is good, what is gentle. Then refraining from frivolous talk, endless talking. Sometimes people get together, they start to talk with a very little subject. But perhaps hours and hours talk, at the end say, "Oh, where have we started?" Because endless talking, Buddha said, stop such talk. Talk when it is right. Talk something beneficial for you. Something on Dhamma, otherwise just keep silent. Dhammiva kata ariyova tunhi bhava. Either talk something on Dhamma or observe noble silence. That is the advice of Buddha. Then when we talk as we have right understanding, right thinking, then we put this into practice, put it into word. When we put this into word, what we talk should put into action. That is what is called right action. Right action, action is karma. Our action should be good karma. Refraining, we have three types of action, three modes of actions: bodily actions, verbal actions, and mental action. Here it is our bodily actions. Using this body, we have the tendency to kill. But as Buddhist, as cultured people, as civilized people, we refrain from killing. Refrain from killing is not only refrain in killing. We can refrain from killing, but we can ask somebody else to kill. Or we can approve killing by supporting. All these are to be stopped. Killing means that. Refraining from killing means that. You neither kill nor get somebody else to kill, nor approve any type of killing. That is how we refrain from killing. Then refraining from stealing, the same. You neither steal nor get somebody else to kill or approve any type of killing, stealing. Sexual misconduct, false speech, and taking intoxicant, the same. 5 precepts. So then the Buddha taught us to refrain from this and practice, do what is right, right actions. Then when we have right actions, we live rightly. That is what is called right livelihood. Right livelihood is very important. Right livelihood, the Buddha taught us what is right livelihood. Right livelihood is right living. Rightly, we have to live rightly, righteously. In order to live righteously, we have to earn righteously. That is important. Earning righteously. When we earn righteously, we live righteously. We can live righteously. The Buddha taught Dhamma to be happy. To be happy here in this world and hereafter. For this purpose, Buddha said, Ditta Dhamma Sukhaya. Ditta Dhamma Sukha means happiness here in this world. Samparaya Sukhaya, next world. Happy here and the hereafter. For this purpose, once when a certain person named Ujjaya, he went to the Buddha and he said, Bhante, I am going to move to another state, another city. Please tell us something for the benefit of this world and the next world. Where the Buddha pointed out 8 factors for the accomplishment of this world and the next world. Happiness of this world and the next world. What are the 8 factors? Buddha said, do things ardently. Make effort. In your day-to-day life, make effort to do things properly. Uttana Sampada. Make effort to earn. When you earn, the Buddha said, earn 7 types of wealth. 7 types of wealth. Not only money. Money is not enough. We try to earn money. Money itself is not enough. Money cannot do everything. Buddha said, earn confidence. Saddha is a wealth. Saddha, what is saddha? Saddha is confidence, conviction, trust. Trust in the Buddha. Trust in the Dhamma. Trust in the Sangha. We trust Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. That is our confidence. We have a confidence. That confidence is, we have confidence that Buddha is the matchless refuge. Dhamma is the matchless refuge. Sangha is the matchless refuge. That is our confidence. That is our Shraddha. It's a wealth. If you have Shraddha, that is a wealth. Saddha Dhanang. Secondly, Sila Dhanang. Sila, our virtue. if we have virtue, if we can refrain from doing unwholesome deeds, it's a virtue. Like five precepts, we can recollect this, we can contemplate on this sila. Whenever we think of our own sila, we can be happy. That itself is a wealth. Sila dhanang. Then hiri is shame. Shame to do unwholesome deeds. We should have shame. We should be ashamed to do unwholesome deeds. Saddha dhanam, sila dhanam, hiri dhanam, ottappa dhanam. Ottappa is fear of doing unwholesome deeds. That itself is a wealth. Then sutta dhanam. Sutta means learning, listening, dhamma. Learning the dhamma and listening the dhamma. Sutta dhanam. Then the sixth is chaga dhanang. Chaga means generosity, practice generosity. If you are generous, that itself is a wealth. Then the last, panya dhanang. Panya means wisdom. Wisdom itself is a wealth. So we have to earn this. Then our life is successful. Otherwise, simply earning money, earning material things, many different kinds of gadgets, thinking mine, that is how we earn. If we collect these things, if we hoard such things, eventually, one day, we have to leave behind even this body and go. Then no such qualities. No spirituality. Nothing gain spiritually. That is why Buddha taught us to earn with effort. Uttana sampada. He taught this person, Ujjaya. Uttana sampada. Do things with effort. Earn wealth with effort. Earn money or this wealth when you are young. This is the teaching. When you are young, not when you are very old. Some people think that now still I am young. I have time. Still young. So they are not doing good deeds. The Buddha's instructions is do things, earn when you are young. Secondly, Buddha said, protect what you earn. Arakha sampada. Protect what you earn without wasting your money, wasting your time, wasting your energy. Without wasting your energy. Protect it. That is the second thing. Uttana sampada, arakka sampada. These are the accomplishment of life. Then kalyana mittata, associate with a good friend. Kalyana mitta. Kalyana mittata. Then live a balanced life, understanding your income and expenditure. Live a balanced life. These are for the accomplishment of this life, for the happiness, benefit of this life. Then for the next life, Buddha said, saddha sampada, again, saddha, confidence. You see how the importance of saddha? Saddha sampada. Then sila sampada. Sila is morality. Virtue. Chaga sampada. Chaga is generosity again. Then panya sampada. Wisdom. All these are quite interconnected. This is how we become happy here in this world and hereafter. Once the Buddha said four things for the benefit of this world, for the happiness of this world. You know, the Buddha taught the Dhamma to be happy here. Even the highest bliss is here in this world. Nibbana is here in this world. Buddha said, one has to have happiness of his life whenever he thinks, whenever she thinks of his life. Atthi sukha, bhoga sukha, anana sukha and anavajya sukha. Four types of happiness. Atthi sukha. Atthi sukha means one has to have happiness that one has money, one is possessed with some wealth. That's the possession of wealth. Then you can be happy. When you have money, when you have any sort of health, wealth, you can be happy. Then Atthi sukha, that is called Atthi sukha. Then the second one is bhoga sukha. Bhoga means you are consuming your wealth. You earn money, you consume it. That is the purpose of money, purpose of wealth. Once you earn, you have to consume things. If you hoard things, that is not for you. That is for other purpose. That's for maybe for rats, cockroaches, or fire, or water, or the government. Not for you. If you simply hoard things, therefore consume, then you can be happy. Then anana sukha. Anana means no debt, debtless. Be a debtless person. No debt. No, you are not a debtor. Debtlessness is a cause for happiness. Anana sukha. Then anavajya sukha. Refrain, completely refrain from all unwholesome. Then you can be happy. Such a way the Buddha taught us the Dhamma. To be happy. These are the qualities we have to think of this. These are the qualities to nurture. As a lay person, these are the qualities to be nurtured. So then the Buddha taught us effort, make an effort, live righteously, and then said make effort. That is called right effort. Right effort. Effort is to be made for the success of our worldly life. Worldly life. And for the success of our spiritual life. When we make effort, that is energy. We should have energy to do our deeds, do our actions properly, at the right time. We should have energy, effort. Then when we practice, we have to understand our mind. That is what is called right striving. Right striving. Samma vayama. We have to make effort to avoid unwholesome thoughts. We have to make effort to overcome unwholesome thoughts. Then we have to make effort to develop wholesome thought and also to maintain wholesome thoughts. In other words, we have to make effort to restrain our senses. We have to make effort to avoid, to abandon unwholesome thoughts. We have to develop our mind and we have to maintain that development of mind. That is called right effort. With that right effort we put into practice as a spiritual person, that is where we practice mindfulness, which is called right mindfulness, as the seventh factor of the path. When we have right effort, right mindfulness, we can come to right concentration. Right mindfulness is to be practiced all the time. It is not only while we are sitting on the cushion. It is part and parcel of our life. Right mindfulness. When we are mindful, we are in the present moment. When we are in the present moment, we are happy. Once a certain deity came to the Buddha and said, "Bhante, your disciples, they take meal only once a day. They live in deep woods, deep forest. But their faces are very beautiful, pleasant faces. They are very beautiful. What is the cause? What is the reason, Bhante?" The deity asked. Then the Buddha said, "They need to repent on their past. There's nothing for them to repent. They need to repent on their past or the future. They don't worry about their future. They do not build castle in the skies. They are not worrying about the past or the future, but live in the present moment." Buddha said, "This is the secret. This is the cause for happiness. This is why their faces are beautiful. Pleasant face." So, if we are mindful, we can be happy. We live happily, peacefully. That is the way. Mindfulness means attention, awareness, alertness, earnestness. If you are attentive, you are mindful. Like that. So, when we practice mindfulness, we have to have concentration as well. Concentration is called right concentration. Right concentration is possible with the support of the first seven factors of the path. That is to be understood clearly. Without the support of first seven factors of the path, no right concentration. Without right concentration, nobody can come to right knowledge and right liberation. So friends, this is how we have to understand this Dhamma. These are the qualities. These are the qualities to be nurtured, to be developed by all of us, so that we can understand this Dhamma, we can realize this Dhamma, one day we can attain supreme bliss of Nibbana. Even this practice, it is because of this practice, nurturing this Dhamma. So let's all understand this Dhamma, let's all practice this Dhamma, so that one day we can realize real peace, real happiness of Nibbana. May we all attain supreme bliss of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Brothers and sisters, we are very fortunate to listen to Bhante's talk on how to nurture all the Noble Eightfold Path in the daily life. Now, both venerables will have to take their lunch, so let us be in anjali position and pay respect by bowing three times. First bow.
Sukhi hoto.
Second bow.
Sukhi hoto.
Third bow.
Sukhi hoto.